Well, hello, everybody. Hello and welcome. Welcome to you who are right here with me. Welcome to those of you who are watching right now with us. And hello to any of you who are going to see this a little bit later as well. But I'm Borden Scott. I'm the pastor here at Faith Baptist. And we're excited to have you with us. I think we might have set a new attendance record here in person today since coming back. So that's exciting. We're glad to see your faces. And whether you've been having just one of the best weeks in a while, or whether this has been whether it's been a struggle, we are glad to be able to come together today to worship. God rejoices with the good, with the normal. He sustains us through the hardship. Wherever you are, whatever's going on with you, however you came this morning, or however you decided to tune in this morning, God is here. God is with us. Yesterday, my family and I had a really nice day. We hadn't gone and done anything much for a while. Things, of course, been a little busy and a few extra challenges on top of that. So it'd been a little while since we'd gone and done anything at all. So our youngest is about to have her second birthday. So we took off down to the valley, to the Aylesford Zoo, and a couple of farm markets and things like that. And it was just such a wonderful day because it was so it felt so almost normal. we had to wear masks a couple places we went, and the zoo was changed around a little bit and some of these kinds of things. But overall, it seemed like the normal kind of a family outing that you would have done. And it's been a long time, it seems like, since you got to do just a really fun, normal thing like that. And I was thinking about that and how some of these nice touches were, getting to go and, the kids just having a great time running around and looking at the animals. If you have an hour to spare sometime, you can ask Corinne about the camel that bonked his head, and she will tell you about it for as long as you want to listen to that. Spent $6 on a box of fresh Annapolis Valley strawberries at the end of October. I don't know where they came from, but it was worth it. but this had me thinking a little bit about what it's like for us right now. We're about 6 weeks into, this trying to figure it out period of some of you are here, some of you are out there. We're trying to do worship in a way that makes sense for both groups at the same time. And if there's anybody who's kind of hoping that they can walk back in and get the normal experience that they remember, we know that through this season, we're not going to have that. That's not really something that we're going to be able to expect. There are barriers now. There's the barrier of that screen between you and us, or the weirdness of being on your own or with a couple other people watching, or the barriers of, these seats between us and the masks that we're wearing and the instructions to, please, just sing really quietly, don't get too excited. And so that, those things are there. And so I was reflecting on this a little bit this week and just saying, we have to adjust the way we understand worship a little bit, because for better or worse, I think for a long time the church has been trying to create this worship experience that's you just sit down and we will try to sweep you away, right? We will try to do the music and the preaching and all the touches that just kind of sweep you away, so you don't have to think about it, you don't have to do anything, you just come and receive. And for better or worse, that's not where we are anymore. And so if we're going to come through this and not just think, well, this isn't good anymore. We have a relative of ours, a family member who's older and, finding this time kind of hard. And we were asking, someone was asking, have you gotten back to church? And she said, well, yes, but I don't like it. I get that. If we're aiming for what we had, then it comes off as a bit of a letdown. It comes off as a bit of a disappointment. It's not what we had. And so the only way we get through this, I think, in a way that our worship continues to be valuable, continues to help and change us, is if we make sure that we are not focused on coming to receive, but that we are focused on coming to bring that offering of praise, that offering of our presence, that offering of our attention to God. We have to come and make that our offering to God. And in the upside down wonderful way that God works, I believe that if we do that, we will still receive, that we will absolutely receive from God. But I think that is our path through this season, is to make sure that we're thinking, I am here because God is worthy of my praise. God is worthy of my attention. God is worthy of my time. And so that is why I come and I offer my worship to him, and I trust that I will receive when I do that. And maybe that'll be a positive thing, because I worry that there were times where there were a lot of Christians who felt like, I can come, and the church's job is to break through all my barriers. You know, the church's job is to have a worship experience that breaks through my tiredness, my lack of interest, my lack of paying attention, my lack of reading my own Bible, my lack of praying on my own. I'm supposed to just come, and they're supposed to find a way through all that to get God into me. Well, that was never a good attitude. I don't think that ever worked very well. Don't think a lot of hearts got changed through that. But certainly it's not one we can bring anymore. And so maybe that's some of the good God will do in that season. All right, there's another sermon coming, so I'm going to wrap that one up. But I want to read to you Psalm 25, just along those lines. It says, "Show me your ways, Lord. Teach me your paths. Guide me in your truth and teach me, for you are God, my Savior, and my hope is in you all day long. Remember, Lord, your great mercy and love, for they are from of old. Do not remember the sins of my youth and my rebellious ways. According to your love, remember me. For you, Lord, are good. Good and upright is the Lord, therefore he instructs sinners in his ways. He guides the humble in what is right, and he teaches them his way." Let's be humble people who God can guide, and let's come together in a word of prayer. Loving God, I thank you for this day, that we are able to bring this offering of praise to you, whether we've brought ourselves into this building physically, whether we've set aside this time in front of our screen to seek to participate in worship today. Would you help us to open our hearts and minds to you, trusting that you will give us something we need? Help us to open our soul to you for the hurts, the struggles, the challenges, the things that we need you to minister to, so that we can not just get through, but get through as your people, as people who will bring honor to your name, people who will be an example and a witness to you in this world that could use some hope and some good examples and some confidence about what's happening and the fact that maybe you don't feel like you can trust some of the things you used to be able to trust. But God is there and worthy of our trust. So, Lord, I pray that you would give us the freedom to worship in the way that we can, in the ways that we should this morning, and ask your Holy Spirit to meet us here. In Jesus' name, amen. Our one or two announcements I want to note for you. Our Thanksgiving offering sort of continues. If you would like to still contribute to it, we're trying to complete the fundraising mission for our AED, that automated defibrillator that's going to be in this building for anyone who might have an emergency and need that. And so there are still extra offering envelopes or the e-transfer option for that. Our craft dinner project, we're getting close. The number was rising all morning. I think it's closing in on 300. Not quite there yet. Oh, we hit 300. Okay, great. So the only problem with that is at some point I told you the goal was 300, but it's actually 350. So we're doing great. But we do have one more week. So if you're able to, that's great. Or if you want to bring some, not on a Sunday service, but to our drop-off day, October 31st, coming right up, Halloween Day, 10 o'clock to 12. We're having just a drive-in drop-off time here at the church just to invite our congregation, but also our friends, our neighbors, our community to come and help refill Beacon House a little bit, because they're starting to feel a strain, and I suspect it'll only get worse as we head into the winter. So that's just an opportunity for you as well. So you can bring whatever items you want for that, but if you want to bring some craft dinner for us, then it's great too.
In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are still and striving cease. My comforter, my all and all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe, this gift of love and righteousness. Oh. by the ones he came to save. Till on the cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid. Here in the death of Christ I live. Bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, sin's curse has lost its grip on me. For I am his and he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ.
Good morning, everyone. Let's pray together. Father, as we gather here, all these people, I'm just so thankful. Even those that are online, we come together as a community and we lift your name in praise. We thank you for your grace and love. We take some time to think of the sins in our lives and to confess them to you, to leave them at the foot of the cross. We thank you that you have redeemed and restored us. We thank you for your continued presence with us. Today we think about those who are suffering, those who are sick, we ask for healing. Those who are feeling broken, we ask for your presence with them. We think of the family and friends of Reverend Tracy Gross, who they're mourning her loss. We ask that you would walk beside them, providing comfort for them to lean on. We invite the Holy Spirit to move among us, to dwell in each of our hearts. As we listen to today's message, that you would challenge us, comfort us, and give us a desire to learn more about your ways. We pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Doesn't seem fair, does it? I get to take off my mask. This right here. So Borden might have thanked me prematurely for coming this morning. I said to him today, I said, you shouldn't thank me until afterwards. You may regret this. But then I realized that maybe it was part of a strategy, because by having me here this week, you are going to be very glad to have him back in a couple of weeks, right? So this was all just part of his pastoral strategy. Thanks for having me here today, and thanks for being sharing this with me today. I really appreciate you being here, and I appreciate the opportunity to be here. We're going to talk about blind spots, and because we all have them, right? And they're in our lives. We can't see them because we are who we are. We live in our own skin. And so it's not often we get a chance to recognize our blind spots, but you can guarantee that the people around us do, right? If you are married and you say to your spouse, what's my blind spot? They're going to know. And they've probably been waiting 20 or 30 years for you to ask the question. And so it's so true of ourselves that we have these blind spots. But even more importantly, and maybe just as critically, it is very, very true also that within our church organizations, within our faith journeys, within our churches, we have some significant blind spots as well. And we don't recognize them because we come to church every week and we do church, right? And we sit and like, so just so you know, Borden and I did not coordinate this. It's important to note, right, that he didn't ask me to say these things. I had a guest speaker at our church once, and afterwards, and they said quite a few, like, really just convicting things. And afterwards, that congregation member come up and say, did you tell him to say these things? And I said, no, but did they hit home? And so, anyway, so we haven't coordinated with this, although with this introduction, it was like, wow, okay, there's the Spirit at work. So we have a way of doing church. We have a way of sort of coming to church and being the church. And we get caught up in those ways so much so that sometimes we don't see our own blind spots. But you know who really does? The people that are not in our churches. The people outside the churches that look in and they see, you know, what we do and versus what we say. You know, they watch your Facebook posts. And they know what you represent from your Facebook posts, your tweets, if you tweet. Anyone tweet here? Wrong crowd? Yeah, okay. Your lawn signs, maybe your lawn signs, how's that? And they watch these things, they see how we live, they see how we spend our money, they see how we share, they see how we spend our time. They see it in what we do say, and more importantly, they see it in what we don't say. In fact, our silence can say much more about where we put our priorities and what we believe and what we stand for and what we support. It can say much more than the words that we say. And so they watch this and they start asking questions. Because after all, as a church, we say to people, we say, hey, God is the answer, right? It's true. We say, God is the answer. Jesus is the answer to a lot of this world's problems, all these world's problems. If we could all just get behind Jesus, this world would be a much better place. And so they listen to that, and then they watch us, and they start asking the questions. Is it true? Is the church really the answer? Is the church really the cure? Is the church really supposed to be, is it really this blessing that they talk about? Or is it the curse? Do you know what a blessing is? Have you heard? You know what a blessing is, right? Yeah, we talk about it in church. And what's interesting is I bet you there's a few people here or even at home that are going, actually, no one's really, we talk about it at church, but no one's really said what it is, right? Because we just have these buzzwords and we use them. Well, there's several meanings of the word blessing, and especially in the Hebrew. In the Hebrew, they have a main word for blessing, and it is. You can go to the next slide. He is lost. I gave him a script, and I said, good luck. So in case you're wondering, poor guy, you're doing great. Barak, like Obama, but spelt differently. Barak is the root form of the word blessing in Hebrew. And look at the definition that the Hebrews or the Jews would understand this word to be. They say it's to kneel or to bring a gift to another while kneeling out of respect. Or the extended meaning was to do or give something of value to another. But look at that first meaning here. To kneel or to bring a gift to another while kneeling out of respect. That is not the modern day Christian way of thinking of blessing. Because the person that does the blessing is usually the person that is... I do this all the time. You can shout out an answer if you want. Google right ahead. The person that is doing the blessing, right? The person that's being blessed is usually the person that's on their knees. Yeah. Yeah, have you ever done a laying on of hands? You ever commissioned somebody? The person gets down on the front and they circle you and their hands come out over top, right? Or we bless something and the hands come out over top, but the person that's receiving the blessing is always the one on their knees. In the Jewish way of thinking, it was exactly the opposite. The person doing the blessing would be on their knees, blessing the person who would be standing in front of them. This is important for us to know as we go through our chat this morning. It changes our perspective and should change our perspective and our approach as Christians when we think about, are we a blessing in this world or are we a curse? So we're going to look at Genesis 12. We're going to dive into that, and we're going to look at Beatitudes quickly, and Borden's going to do this when he wants me to stop. So Genesis 12 is about Abraham, right? And God told Abraham, but I'm going to call him Abraham because we all know that's what he becomes. God told Abraham, leave your country, your family, and your father's home for a land that I will show you, right? So God starts off and says, Abraham, I'm not going to ask for a lot. I'm just going to ask you basically just to walk away from just about everything you know and go to this land that I show you. And then he says, I'll make you a great nation. So do this, and I'll make you a great nation, and I will bless you, and I'll make you famous. Right? I was going to say stuff like YouTube famous or TikTok, but again, wrong crowd, right? Yeah. At home, so I'm just kidding. But you know, everyone wants their 15 seconds of fame, right? Or maybe not. Maybe you folks don't, but boy, oh boy, they line up for it. Look, the whole reason stuff like YouTube exists, as far as I'm concerned, is so that people can get out there and get follows and likes and views and all these things, because everyone wants that 15 seconds of fame. But in Abraham's case, he got famous. God kept his promise. Here we are 5,000 years later, sitting in this church, talking about Abraham. And in the Christian faith, we all know who Abraham is for the most part. In the Jewish tradition, they call him Father Abraham. In the Muslim tradition, they look at Abraham as a significant person in their faith system. You put those three faiths together, and I guess he's only known by a few billion people in today's world. You can't get much more famous. So God keeps his promise and says, and Abraham does become famous, not just in his day, but down through the ages. And so he says, I'll make you a great nation and bless you. And then he follows up with this. And we can miss this so easily, but it's so important. This is like a crucial part of the verse. He says, and you'll be a blessing. It's not you might be a blessing, or hey Abraham, if I do this for you, you should be a blessing, or hey Abraham, if I do this for you, I'd like you to bless some people. It is a directive. It is a command. It is a direction as much as the commandments, if you will. It's as much as when Jesus says, a new command I give you, love one another. This is a direction straight from the beginning of the Bible in Genesis. And how beautiful is it to see that in Genesis and know that it carries all the way through the Bible. This, my friends, is a mega theme of what God wants us to be about. You will be a blessing. I will bless you, and you will bless others. And we know God keeps his promises, so now we know God has an expectation. And then he says, I'll bless those who bless you. That's great, right? I'll curse those who curse you, I'll curse, which is a little dark and ominous by the sounds of things, right? But then the most important sentences, and we get caught up on that sometimes because we say, yeah, you know, yeah, those who stand against us stand against God. Bring it, you know, and that's not what this verse is about. But the most important part of the verse is this. All the families of the earth will be blessed through you. And Abraham says, whoa, and he puts his hand up And he says, God, can you say that again? Because I think I misheard something. And God says, yeah, Abraham, all the families on earth will be blessed through you. Completely countercultural to what the understanding of the day was. Because in that day, you didn't bless other families. You looked after your own. It was a tribal system where your tribe had your space and your land and your sheep. And if the tribe over there had more water or resources or whatever, then you would go and attack that tribe and take it from them to preserve your own tribe. It was all about your tribe, the preservation of your tribe, the flourishment, the prosperity of your tribe. And if there was a neighboring tribe, a neighboring group that was a threat, there was only one thing he could do about that. So the culture wasn't to bless other tribes, right? It was to obliterate them. And God comes along and says, I'm going to, like, all the families of the earth will be blessed through you. Now, in Abraham's day, it was a little simpler to put a quantity on that or put an understanding of that, because he would say, hey, God, do you mean that tribe two hills over and one to the right, one stream to the right, that? Yeah, them too? And I'm like, yeah, them too. But today, think about what this is telling us. It means there's not a single person on this earth, not a single person on this earth, whether we agree with them or not, whether we understand them or not, whether we are, you know, we fit in with them or not, there's not a single person on this earth that, as Jesus followers, as people who believe in God, we are not to be a blessing to. Isn't that fun? Man, the Bible's so much fun, isn't it? Yeah, people should read it a lot more all the time, because, I mean, it's just, there's so much in it, and it's so rich, and it gets you so excited, because you see the potential that God has for our lives. Jesus picks up on this theme. We're going to jump right over to Beatitudes. I'm going to go through them fairly quickly because there's a number of them. And this is this section, and it doesn't say it here, but what's the traditional wording for this? Blessed are they. Remember the traditional, like, that's what we really resonate with. You'll find it in, like, communal readings and so on. So I took it from the NLT, so we're going to switch it up a little bit here. But this is it. God blesses those who are poor and realize their need for him, for the kingdom of heaven is theirs. We're going to start looking at postures that Jesus is pointing to, and he picks up on this theme that happens between God and Abraham, and he brings it into the New Testament. He gets up on the Sermon on the Mount, and he goes right, because this is his first sermon, he goes right back to the beginning. He says, well, I might as well start here, because that's where God started. So here we go. So the posture here is this. Blessed are those who are poor and realize their need for him, for the kingdom of heaven is theirs. I read this beautiful piece in one of the commentaries I was looking at prior to this morning, and the commentary writer said, we forget sometimes that heaven isn't full of stuff. And heaven doesn't worry about your position or your power or your priorities or whatever. You know the old expression, you can't take it with you? Yeah. And he says, for those people that have let go of things, those people that have released things, that aren't hanging on to stuff or their power or their positions or whatever else might be their status in society, if you've already released that stuff, you're going to fit into heaven really, really well, because it's already set up that way. Blessed are those who have a posture of being poor in spirit. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. We've all lost something, and it sounds strange when we say blessed are those who mourn, because we all know, well, most of us, I would say, know what it's like to mourn and to grieve for the loss of someone or something. But the beautiful implication here is blessed are those who mourn, because in the moment of mourning, and again, here's your posture, in the moment of mourning, you recognize something is wrong. Something is broken. Something isn't the way it's supposed to be. In that particular moment, you probably, whether you realize it or not, most identify with God in such a way that says, God, your creation isn't right. It's broken and it needs to be fixed and healed. And God comes alongside and says, I know. Isn't it horrible? I grieve with you for the sin of the world and the brokenness of our world and for what has happened to you, because it shouldn't have happened this way, but it has. Blessed are those that are open enough to see the sin of the world as something that God doesn't want, but that affects us all of creation. It goes on and says, God blesses those who are humble, for they will inherit the earth. Like the meek shall inherit the earth. We use that all the time. Movies use that all the time too, right? But here's it makes sense. Have you ever been blessed by someone who's proud? Maybe. I mean, it probably didn't feel good. You know, when someone said, "Hey, here's a I'm gonna help you," and it didn't come from their heart. But I'll ask you this question: Can you think of somebody right now that, in all humility, stepped into your life in a moment of need and blessed you? If I gave you 10 seconds to come up with a name, you don't have to say it out loud. But if I gave you 10 seconds, I guarantee that in those 10 seconds, someone's going to flash into your mind and you're going to say, that person, when this happened, beautifully cared for me in a humble way. Blessed. It's posture. It's a posture that he's taking here, right? Blessed are those who are humble. And he says, God blesses those who hunger and thirst for justice, for they will be satisfied. Look at this posture. This isn't just someone who says, there's something going on, I'm going to make a Facebook post. That happened, I should get involved for a little while. This is someone who craves justice like it is nourishment for their bodies. This is someone who looks at justice and says, I cannot help but pursue justice, because in the same way I need food and water, I need to have a voice for those people who do not have a voice. It's a posture. God blesses those who are merciful, for they will be shown mercy, and blesses those whose hearts are pure, for they will see God. So as we go through this, we're almost at the end, you see the posture, right? Is this starting to become, there's a pattern? Is it becoming evident? Are you seeing something happen here? Because all of these things are from the meaning of blessing in Hebrew? All of the things we're talking about, all of these things that are listed here in the Beatitudes are from a position of kneeling, serving, being humble, merciful. This is all from a position of, this isn't you people standing up here and saying, here, we can help you. Here, we can help you. We've come to save you. This is a position from being in a kneeling position, a posture of humility that says, wow, we are here to bless. And if we do anything else, forgive us for that, because we've been called to bless. God blesses those who work for peace, for they will be called the children of God. Oh, man. Beautiful. God blesses those who are persecuted for doing the right thing, for the kingdom of heaven is theirs. God blesses those who speak out, even though it costs them something. God blesses people that take a stand on an issue, even though they may lose friends, even though people may judge them over it, even though people will look at them and say, well, that's not scriptural, or that's not right, or I'm not comfortable with that. But God blesses those who deep down know it's right and says, but I am, and I feel that conviction. The Spirit has moved. I will stand on this truth. I will stand with these people because it's the right thing to do. A posture of coming alongside. As people who follow Jesus, the time for us sitting on the sidelines is long past. I don't know. Does it bother you to watch the news? It bothers me to watch the news. It really bothers me to watch the news. When I watch the news, when I watch the news and evangelicals are standing in protest movements and saying things that they should not say, supporting things that no Jesus follower should support, and cheering for a man who all he does is ridicule his opponents and lies and deceives and has no integrity. I don't know who I'm talking about, do you? And here's the thing, I know there are people in Canada that certainly like this guy. And I know there's some people in Canada that are Christians that like this fella. I just don't get it. Because we are never to assume that kind of a posture in our faith. As soon as we do, we become the curse. Right? The curse is out there. The curse is everywhere. The curse of sin is everywhere. It's breaking people apart. It's tearing us apart in our relationships. It's causing us to hate each other and to protest against each other. It's causing us to push other people aside so we get our place at the front of the line. That's all part of the curse. If we join in on that, how are we different from the rest of the world? And how can we say that we are following in the footsteps of Jesus? Yeah. So silence is not an option. Silence is complicit. We have to speak up on behalf of other people, risk our own position at the front of the line, right? If we're privileged and we don't recognize it, we're doing something wrong. We have to recognize where other people, and it happens right here in Nova Scotia. This is not an American problem, right? This is not another world problem. This is a Nova Scotian problem. So we have to ask ourselves things like this. How can we be anti-racist? Not how can we not be racist? Because most of us here would probably say, or all of us would say, I'm not racist. But how can we be anti-racist? How can we stand alongside our black brothers and sisters in Nova Scotia and say, we are with you in the injustices that are happening right here in our backyard? It's our job. How can we be a blessing to them? Like how about our indigenous brothers and sisters with all the stuff that's going on with the lobster stuff? I don't know enough about it. I'm not taking sides, actually. But how on earth can we stand alongside them and recognize the fact that, hey, folks, whether we agree with them now or not, it doesn't matter, because there's this word called colonization that created incredible injustice, and it needs to be repaired. And unfortunately, the church of the day was at the forefront of some of that injustice. And we are part of that. I didn't know this. I was talking to a social worker, and she said, well, Kevin, did you know that there was a residential school not 15 or 20 kilometers away that was open until sometime in the 1990s? And I thought, no, but I should have, because I'm old enough to be part of that. I think we all are. So what role do we play in this? How do we come alongside and say, how can I help? We can't fix the past, but we can recognize the harm, and we can step in to be the blessing that changes the way things happen. Because that's what Jesus lays on our hearts, to be the blessing, to be the change. A new command I give you, says Jesus, love one another, because by doing that, then they will know that you are my disciples. That's how they'll know. Not because we have pretty words or nice buildings, not because we have a great message, but because we will love one another unconditionally. And we will be the blessing that God asked Abraham to be from 5,000 years ago, and we'll live it out today. Yeah. So we can't pick and choose anymore. We've got to bless people. We know that. But in the doing of it, it's all about our posture. We're not going in racing in to save anybody. We're not going into like we are coming in to ask the question, how can we help? I think. And if you look at the Beatitudes postures that Jesus left us with, right, and I'm sure he was building on Abraham and the blessing of Abraham. If we look at those things, we will be serving with humility by showing a posture of this soul poverty. This posture that says, you know, God, I too am unworthy of your grace and your mercy. I am not better than people around me. I do not have, you know, more blessing because I happen to be in this church. I am just as great a sinner as anybody else, and yet I have this beautiful relationship with Jesus that I have as a blessing at my fingertips. And God, you've given it to me so I can share this. Mourning with people over the sickness of our world, and it's not just sickness, their loss, mourning with them in their loss, and being a comfort to them in the same way that God is a comfort to us in our time of need. Right? Finding ways to heal in this world without having platforms, pointing fingers, starting a fight. Has anyone ever start? Maybe you have. Has anyone here a scrapper in your young days? Anyone here scrap? No? I fought once when I was a kid. I was in grade 2. The school called my parents. This guy pushed this little girl out of line, and I thought I'd be a hero. So I got into a fight. It's the last fight I was ever in. Yeah. Mom and Dad never let me forget that. But have you ever tried to start a fight from this position? Some of you may not see me. Have you ever tried to fight from here? Good luck with that. Yeah. Good luck with that. Humility. Love with this pureness of heart without judgment or pride. Show mercy. Again, it's all about posture. Show mercy. Thirst for justice. Work for peace. Risk persecution. Love your neighbor. Love all your neighbors. Love all the families of this world, regardless of whether they see eye to eye with you, whether they come from the same place as you, whether they look like you, whether they're male or female or whatever they identify as. It doesn't matter. We are in a place where we love all the people. And Abraham was told by God that the posture he wanted Abraham to do it was from his knees. Let's pray. So Father, here we are this morning, and Lord, it's been a blessing to be here together this morning and in this church. God, we pray that this church can continue to do what it's been doing, to continue to reach out into the community, continue, God, to be looking for ways to serve and to reach and to come alongside, to support each other, but also to support those people outside our church that are looking at us and saying, what are you? Asking us the question, are we the answer? God, we know we have the answer, and we know we have the truth, but help us, God, to show it through our love, not just our words, but definitely our love. And may we be the blessing that Abraham was to be 5,000 years ago to the people of this community, the people of our city, and the people of our province. Help us, Lord, to be the voice from our knees. Love you, God. Amen.
We're going to move to another song in just a moment. We're going to invite you to sing with this song video if you feel comfortable doing that. Great is thy faithfulness. And we've talked a few times recently about how at the root of sin, at the root of the fall even of people, was this great lie that says God can't be trusted. Therefore, you've got to do for yourself. You've got to take for yourself. You've got to, you know, you have to make these things that you want happen for yourself, and don't listen to him. He's just going to get in your way. That's kind of at the core. And so I think this song is helpful to us, because we can't be a blessing. We can't do right if we don't believe that God will then come alongside and sustain us through that, bless us through that, help us through that, be there for us through that. If we're not sure that he's going to be faithful, then we're not going to do much good for anyone else either. And so, you know, it's the idea that do what God asks us to do. That's all we can do. The outcome belongs to him, and he is faithful. Let's join together in this worship through song.
Great is thy faithfulness, Lord.
to just receive this this blessing for today. Let's pray together. Lord God, I pray that you would bless each one here this morning. Would you bless us with that poverty of spirit to be able to recognize our need for you and our dependence on you? Would you bless us by comforting us when we do mourn losses of things or people, and give us that recognition that the brokenness in this world shows us that there is a world yet to come that we should yearn for. Bless those who are meek, those who have power but which is under control. Put them in the positions of authority where they can exercise good leadership and judgment and be a blessing to this world in ways large and small. Bless those who would show compassion on others so that they would grow a heart like yours. In all these things, Lord God, we pray that you would bless us with those qualities, with that example, with the ability to follow your Son, Jesus Christ, in a way that blesses all the families of this world. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.